everyone, are all the cameras ready? Thank you for the people participating.
Fab, as the selection issues is challenging this week as opposed to last week.
To a degree, yes. Obviously, the team that we selected last week, we thought was the right team, and it worked really well. But losing Dale, obviously, you know, Dale was the world's best bowler. So he brings that to the table. And now we've got to look at, do we want to keep the same balance of the four seamers and the spinner? Do you look at an extra rounder maybe? So it is... Once again, it's a tough selection, but it's a nice one once again to have.
And how much impact is what you've seen out there in the field?
No, the wicket looks a bit browner than I thought it would be. I think the heat, from what I've got from the groundsman, is that the grass of the wicket's been burnt from the heat in the last week. It was very hot. So we've asked for a place and bounce, so hopefully we'll get that over the next 5 days.
When you look at the candidates that you can choose between, Lungi and Juan were just added to the squad.
Mm-hmm.
Can you just tell us what you're considering about each of them? Obviously, Lungi, he's got home ground, he's had a great summer.
For me, it's obviously right now is really important, but I've also got an eye on the future in terms of looking at, there's a lot of test cricket coming up. We're playing two more against India now, and then we've got four against Australia. And as I've said very often, that the success of our test team is highly dependable on the fast bowlers that we have in our armoury. So that's why Lungi has been brought into the squad. Want to get a closer look at what he can do. Before yesterday, I haven't seen him bowl at all. So it was just great to be, one, to get to know him, and two, to see what he's got, because I believe there's a lot of talent there, but it's something that is obviously important for the next 4 or 5 months. And our fitness of our bowlers is going to be really important. So there's probably about 6 or 7. As you mentioned, Dwan is one of them. Decide on which one we want to go for this game.
So what did you think of him? Have you seen him for the first time?
Yeah, nice, very nice guy. Obviously very, really good manners, went to a good school. Very impressed with his bowling. You know, he bowls a heavy ball, and excited to have him in the group. I think there's a bright future for him ahead, so want to start that journey off with him.
Could you tell us how David Villiers has re-established himself in the test break? And looking at the point of that this is a series against India, he knows most of the guys. How do you see him playing out in this test series? What are the expectations from him?
Our expectations is the same as anyone else in the team. His job is to score big runs and make an impact in with the bat. As you mentioned, it's obviously great to have him back, and I know he's very hungry to do well. So a hungry AB generally means a big run scoring AB. So we're hoping that there's, over the next few months, we're going to get a lot of runs from him.
Floyd?
I just wanted to go back to Dale's potential replacement. When you're looking at a guy like Chris Morris in that equation, obviously, when it's replacing Dale, do you view Chris as a seamer, as an out and out bowling specialist?
Yeah.
Like obviously, he is an all rounder. But when looking at a same replacement, do you view him in the same kind of mould?
Right now, I look at Maury as definitely a fourth seamer replacement. So if you pick four seamers, Maury can be in that four seamers. Consistently wise, I feel he's got a little bit more to do in terms of being a third seamer. You know, if you play three seamers, you consistently have to be on the money. Vernon, Mornay, KG, Dale, those guys are a step above, but definitely as a fourth seamer. So if you play four seamers, he's always someone that gets talked about, because he's got pace, he's got X factor, and obviously he bats as well. So he's a good all-round player.
Yes, sir.
Pat, there's been a lot of talk about the bowling and the two teams, but have you had a word with your batsmen as well to avoid what happened in the second innings?
No, I mean, we... prepare bowling for any conditions, because we want to win test matches. So for me, sitting here as a batsman, the first priority is to win games. And if we play in series where the ball takes the upper hand, then so be it. As long as we're winning, that's fine.
Nawara is obviously now the world's number one test bowler. He's a quite younger player. So how do you see him shape up? How do you see him? How do you see how he has shaped up so far, and how he could probably lead South Africa's attack in the future?
Yeah, incredible athlete. I think that's his strongest attribute. He's just such a strong bowler. He can bowl the whole day. He doesn't get tired, really. He's very, very fit. And that's a great thing to have for a captain, because you know he can throw the ball to him always. I still believe that KG's his best is still to come. I think he's learning a lot as a bowler. Obviously, he's a very young bowler still. But I believe that with his body being so strong the way that it is, and the mind that he has on his shoulders, always looking to improve, I believe that the best of him is still to come.
Aidan Markham spoke yesterday about how Robin Shoals with the legend of the game has helped him sit on the side. What sort of guidance have you guys given him to help him play against like the number one ranked system?
No, we don't focus on the opposition. Our culture is really, really, really strong in making sure that when young guys, or anyone for that matter, coming in the team, that we treat them as they've played 50 or 70 or 100 test matches. Everyone on our team is on the same level, and I think if you have that mindset as a team, it's just easier to come in. It's when you come into a new environment and you feel threatened by big names or personalities in the team, and in our dressing room there's none of that, so it's easier for him to feel at home, because we know that a person that feels at home is a person that's going to contribute and perform a lot better.
Over the last few years, there's been a lot of talk of who's the best in the world. Is it AB de Villiers or Virat Kohli? Now, AB de Villiers, he has performed well in Indian subcontinent against good quality spin bowling. But do you feel Virat Kohli has to perform well here to establish that he's at par or maybe better than AB de Villiers in test cricket?
Anyone that gets judged on being the best in the world, whether it's a bowler, a batsman or a team, I feel you should get judged on playing all around the world.
You mentioned bowler-friendly conditions. Do you think this pitch will be less bowler-friendly than it was at Newlands?
I think so, yes. As I said, for me the key thing is pace and bounce. But if there was a bit of grass on it, then that's fine, because, as I said, we back ourselves. If it was a low-scoring game, we'd want to get 20 or 30 or 50 more, which would happen in Newlands. As you can see over there, there's not a lot of green grass. So I expect a good cricket wicket and hopefully a bit of pace and bounce.
Dennis?
Puff, were you happy with the balance of the team, with the six specialist batsmen, or are you looking maybe for this game to bolster the batting lineup a bit?
In the previous game, we were very happy with it. I felt that certainly myself and the coaches' views is always to try and look for the positive option, the aggressive option, and trying to make sure that whatever way you can have an advantage over a team. Obviously, India is the same. We want to make sure that whatever takes them a little bit out of their comfort zones. And the previous game it was pace, and it worked. So it will be something along the same lines, trying to make sure that we've got bowlers that can challenge them with pace.
Does that put more pressure on the top 16 if you know you don't have a long leash there?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, if you play one less batter, it makes your responsibility as a top six even more. But I don't mind that too much. I think having that extra responsibility is good for our top six. I know that they need to score the runs. Sometimes when you have a long batting lineup, you can take your foot off because someone else might come and do it. We know as a top six, we need to score more runs than the opposition to. If we get totals on the board with the bowlers that we have, we'll bowl sides out.
Okay.
Is it true that your mother-in-law is now a member of parliament?
Oh, you're talking politics. Yeah, she is.
And how does that kind of, I'm sure that's pretty big news in your house. You know, is that a distraction or is it a
reality? No, not at all.
Check?
My sole job, or two jobs that I have, is being a dad and a father in cricket. I don't go anywhere else.
Yeah, Pop, since you have mentioned that there is a less grass on this wicket than you mentioned, do you see that spinners have a bigger role over here than what we have seen?
To be really honest with you, I don't know. Generally, Centurion doesn't spin that much, but there is a thick layer of brown grass on it. So it's not something that we're used to seeing at Centurion. So it's for us at the moment, it's unknown. So we'll see how it plays over the next 5 days. Hopefully it doesn't. As I said, for us to get the conditions that we would like. Obviously, spin the ball must spin as little as possible.
More than a third of your squad has played your cricket here at Centurion, and you keep talking of pace and bounce. So how much of an advantage is that to have so many sort of local boys in the mix?
Yeah, I mean, if pace, I think anywhere in the world, if you've got pace, it's always an advantage. So when you don't have pace, your attack can get one-dimensional. And I feel our attack is a lot of variety in it. So it's a huge X factor for us. And that's why I've said so many times that your results is depending on how good your bowling attack is.
Can I get the last few CS and throws?
What are you expecting from India? What sort of response are you expecting? Because it's must win, essentially.
Oh, I think, I mean, India at times were really good in that first test match, and we expected that. That's why I said post-match, the previous game, that that was one of the best test matches that I've played in, because there was so many ups and downs for both teams. India was in the game for 90% of the game. So it was a fantastic contest between two really strong teams. So I expect that they'll take a lot of positives from that game. They would say that they were not far off. They were close. Their bowlers got 20 wickets in the game. The only part where we were a little bit better than them is we got a little bit more runs in the first innings. I expect another huge performance from them. As I said, they are a remarkably strong team. And for us, it's just making sure that we don't take a step back and relying on a 1-0 lead. And if you do that against a strong team like India, they will pounce on it.
And the last time we spoke to you about Vernon was in England when there were all the fitness issues, and then he comes and takes a career based at Newland. What sort of conversations have you had with him, and how committed is he to his fitness?
Yeah, no, just I was just really impressed to see it. The conversations was well done. The stuff that you've been doing over the off season, I can see that you're looking good, you're bowling well. And at the end of the day, that's what it's all about. You know, it's about getting or trying to get the best out of players, and Vernon is at a place now where he's fitter, so then that's why he's bowling the way that he was bowling. And there were, as I said after the previous game, the most pleasing thing for me to see there was Vern was wanting the ball all the time. He wasn't tired after four overs. He was ready to go. And if we can have Vern like that, then it means we're even more dangerous as bowling attack. So really impressed with the way that he stepped up and made our bowling attack even stronger.
And then with the last one, please.
At what point as a batsman, does sheer pace become a factor in some of the 130, 140?
Yeah. I think for me personally, it's more to do with the pitch. Any pace is, it's only really when it gets to 150 when it's really quick. But generally on the pitch, especially when the pitch is unvariable bounce, if fuller balls are coming past your head and shorter balls are staying down, then pace becomes obviously a little bit more dangerous, because then you're thinking in the back of your head, I'm not sure what the pitch is doing. So hopefully we can see that on this wicket towards the end of the test match.
Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you.